When Christians say they are no longer under the law, they are serious. It's no joke. The question then becomes, what does society call someone who is above the law and upon whom no rule of law applies? They are called anarchists. When I was about 13 years old, I left the religion of Christianity. I was convinced that it was false by observing the lawless behavior of Christians. They were openly lawless. In fact, if you tried to impose God's law on a Christian, he would call you a devil, a legalist. At least, this was my experience. Now, some might say you were going to the wrong church then. Well, I thought that as well, which is why when I was 17, I returned to the religion with a revived heart to not worry about what other Christians were doing or not doing, and to live it for myself. Unfortunately, this didn't work well either. As time wore on, I became increasingly more aware of their lawlessness. It was terrible, for you see, they had grace. It was always there, granting them permission to do what they ought not to do and to act and behave in ways that were not good. God will forgive. In fact, as I was taught, I was already forgiven. God didn't even see my sins anymore. They were blotted out by the blood of Jesus. I guess it's true what Scripture says, bad company corrupts good manners. I was not in good company. I was fellowshipping with a bunch of anarchists. Anarchy, or lawlessness, as the Bible calls it, is built right into the center of all Christian religion. I can hear people saying, well, not in my church. Catholics especially will take offense to this claim. They have plenty of laws. They teach that faith without works is dead. Of course they aren't lawless. So let me clarify, when Scripture says lawlessness, it's talking about a lack of God's laws, not man's laws. He that is without God's law has no law. Man's laws are beggarly in comparison to God's law. There is a grand irony in that whenever I preach to Christians that we must obey God the Father as expressed by his will in the law, they say, all your righteousness is filthy rags. They are actually calling God's righteousness, as outlined in God's law, filthy, when it is in fact their laws that are filthy rags. They do not perceive that the righteousness I'm preaching is not my own, but the righteousness that comes by the faith of Christ, who, through the power of love, never once disobeyed the Father. They have turned things upside down, placing evil for good, bitter for sweet, making righteousness sin. Man's laws are no law at all in comparison to God's. So you may have hundreds of laws in your church. If they aren't God's laws, they are nothing. Can I prove it? You bet. That is what this series is about. It is dedicated to show how Christianity as a whole is lawless despite all of their self-imposed rules, thus being devoid of God's laws. They are, in fact, godless. The first lesson will be how Christianity throws out the law by saying that we now have a new covenant and a new testament. Anyone who has studied Christian dogma at all is going to know just how true it is that Christians teach that the law of God has been abolished and that it has vanished away under Christ. They might not use the word abolished, although some do. They might use the word obsolete. They might even say that it wasn't abolished, it was fulfilled. When you press them, however, as to what that means, they will have a convoluted idea. They will say that when a law is fulfilled, it is no longer in effect, which is preposterous. Let's take the law of murder. Let's say I am so pissed at my boss for stealing my idea, I lie in wait for him in the parking lot with an AK-47. Suddenly, I remember God's law, thou shalt not commit murder. So I repent. Now, technically, while I already have the intent to commit it, and while I'm already angry at him to the point of murder and lying in wait to do so, under Christian dogma, I'm guilty. So why not just go through with it? Christian law says I'm a murderer already in my heart. See the danger in man-made law? We will get to this murderer in your heart idea in greater detail later in the series. My point is, I remember God's law, thou shalt not commit murder, and I repent. I unload my gun, put it away, and change my heart. I have now fulfilled the law that says thou shalt not murder. Does this make the law obsolete? Does this mean the law of murder no longer applies to me? Well, it no longer applies to me, for I am not a murderer. But what if my boss was also planning to kill me, and now I die instead? Of course, the law, thou shalt not murder, isn't done away with. Yet Christians say, now that I fulfill the law by not murdering, the law itself is done away with. Actually, what they are really saying is that the penalty the law requires for my act of murder has been satisfied by Christ's death. So they change it from the law is fulfilled in Christ to the demand of the law for punishment is satisfied. How is this not license to sin? The law says thou shalt not murder, but there is no culpability for the murder. There's no consequences for breaking it and no punishment. They teach because Christ fulfilled the law is done away with. Great! I could turn around and get my gun out again. There's still time to shoot him. I fulfilled the law, therefore it no longer applies. This is the insanity of the man-made rule of law in Christianity. Of course, fulfilling a law doesn't make the law of none effect, neither does it make the law obsolete. It does quite the opposite. It enforces the power and effectiveness of that law in me. By obeying that law, I have established the law, not done away with it. To obey the law, therefore, is the ultimate act of law enforcement. If everyone obeyed the laws, we wouldn't even need law enforcers. I hope you see where I'm going with this. For you see, the only thing that was changed in the law under the new covenant was that the need for law enforcers was eliminated because under the new covenant, people are obeying the law. It really is as simple as that. It's not that the law is no longer in effect, nor is it replaced with the new law. When Christians say that we now have new laws in Christ, I demand to know what they are. Where can I turn to find the laws that Christ wrote? Muhammad gave his followers 114 chapters containing innumerable laws. I say they are innumerable because I tried to Google the question, how many laws are in the Quran, and could not find an answer on the internet. Apparently, no one has ever counted them. Anyway, if Christ were going to eliminate the existing laws of God and institute new ones, you'd think they'd be at least written down somewhere by his disciples, if not recorded by himself. So when Christians say that Christ nailed the law on the cross, what they are actually saying is he eliminated law completely. Their new law becomes no law at all, at least for the Protestants. The Catholics say that the new laws are established by church doctrine and confirmed by the Pope. So for the Catholic, the new laws of the new covenant are the church catechisms. Yet the Protestants have no such thing and reject such claims outright. So at least when it comes to Protestants and evangelicals, the new laws of the new covenant don't exist. Yet not really, because every Christian church has its own rules. So we can rightly assume that by new laws, they mean their laws. So they don't really consider themselves anarchists. They have plenty of laws. They just have rejected God's laws in favor of men's laws. Interestingly enough, the prophets did not take kindly to that sort of thing. Isaiah was the most outspoken about this.
Wherefore the Lord said, for as much as this people draw near me with their mouth, and with their lips do honor me, but have removed their heart far from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men, therefore, behold, I will proceed to do a marvelous work among this people, even a marvelous work and a wonder. For the wisdom of their wise men shall perish, and the understanding of their prudent men shall be hid. Woe unto them that seek deep to hide their counsel from the Lord, and their works are in the dark, and they say, who seeth us, and who knoweth us?
Isaiah did not have good things to say about those who replaced God's precepts with men's precepts. This is why it denounces them in Isaiah as having turned things upside down and putting darkness for light.
Surely your turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. For shall the work say of him that made it, he made me not? Or shall the thing framed say of him that framed it, he had no understanding?
When they dismiss God's law, what are they really doing? They are dismissing the legal authority of the creator of the universe. They are rejecting his wisdom and his desires in favor of their own. They are saying he had no understanding when he gave them these laws himself. In fact, they say this openly, stating that the laws that God gave his people are impossible to follow anyway. Wow, God is that stupid? He gave them laws they can't possibly keep and then insisted they keep them? They know better than God, so they replace his laws with their own. Christ himself quoted Isaiah on this matter when confronting the religious leaders of his day regarding their replacing God's laws with their own.
Ye hypocrites, well did Esaias prophesy of you, saying, These people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth, and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. But in vain they do worship me, teaching four doctrines the commandments of men.
Some Christians, when challenged to identify these new laws that they say Christ gave us, will say, There are only two. Then they will quote,
Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
When Christians say these are new laws of the new covenant, they're taking those verses completely out of context. Christ was not discussing new laws in that text, but rather he was identifying the two greatest laws in the old law.
Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him, and saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law?
So the so-called new laws Christians try to say brought in under the new covenant are not new at all.
He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked. Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which ye had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which ye have heard from the beginning.
The new laws are not new at all. They are the same old laws. In Matthew 22, Christ actually says this by saying, Upon these, the two laws he identifies, hang all the law and the prophets. So Christ didn't institute new laws in the new covenant. Despite what Christians would have you believe, it's not the law that is new, but the covenant. Whenever I challenge a Christian to show me where the scripture says the old law is done away with and a new law put in its place, they go to Hebrews 8 regarding the new covenant.
But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. For finding fault with them, he saith, Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind, and write them in their hearts. And I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor, and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. In that he saith, A new covenant, he hath made the first old. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away.
They do not understand what they are reading. The covenant is not the law. The covenant is the agreement to keep the law in exchange for the benefit of remaining in God's good graces. It's not the law that is replaced, but the covenant and the way the law is administered, enforced, and taught. Christians argue, it says the covenant is ready to vanish away. Even if that were so, that's not talking about the law, it's talking about the agreement.
And for this cause, he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. For where a testament is, there must also, of necessity, be the death of the testator. For a testament is of force after men are dead, Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while the testator liveth. Whereupon neither the first testament was dedicated without blood. For when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves and of goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop and sprinkled both the book and all the people, saying, "This is the blood of the testament which God hath enjoined unto you." Moreover, he sprinkled with blood both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry.
They say, "It's a New Testament in Hebrews 9, which makes the first one old." This is true, and it's sound logic, except they think the law is the testament, but it is not. The law is what gives force to the testament. The testament relies on the law to be valid. It's not the law itself. When I die, what good would my last will and testament do for my children if there were no probate law? It is probate law that says my children and the state must abide by my duly sworn last will and testament. So the law is not the testament. Everyone agrees to abide by the testament because the law demands it. The testament is my stipulation as to what my wishes are, and that only has force if there is a law that empowers the testament. So the law is not the testament, and the testament is not the law. Moses signified his own death by sprinkling of the blood. This was a testament to the agreement he made with God, passing on his inheritance in the promise to all of Israel. His death was not the law itself, but rather the law requires the death before the testament is valid. Moses sealed the testament with the blood of bulls and rams, thus signifying his own death for the remission of past sins, so the law is not the testament. Moses' death, as signified by the blood, made him the testator. What requires the death of the testator for the testament to be in force? The answer is the law. So even Christ was subject to the same law of Moses in order to make his New Testament valid, namely the death of the testator. Therefore, Christ's New Testament was enforced by and subject to the same law as Moses' First Testament. The testament is not the law. The testament obeys the law. So while we have a new covenant in Christ, mediated with better promises and administered in a better way, it's the same law. The law hasn't been abolished nor eliminated. Instead, there is a new testator, a new mediator who brings a better administration of the law and whose blood sacrifice is better, but it's the same law of blood sacrifice. Hebrews 8 says that the new covenant is, "I will write my laws into their hearts." And it also says that how the law is taught has changed. We no longer teach every man his neighbor from a written law, but all shall know the law through the love mentioned by Christ in Matthew 22. This doesn't eliminate God's laws. In fact, it makes them eternal. For as long as your heart is beating, the law is alive and well written there. As long as your mind is working, the law is there written. And guess what? You have eternal life through the new covenant. So the law has not been done away with under the new covenant. It has been strengthened and established better than ever. However, there have been changes made to the law regarding its administration. In fact, this is the very context and subject matter of Hebrews 8. The context of this chapter actually begins in Hebrews 7 when he states that the Levitical priesthood has been eliminated and a new priestly order has been established.
If therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek, and not be called after the order of Aaron? For the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law.
What has been changed is not the law, but how people receive the law, how the law is given, how it is administered, and how it is enforced. So there is a change to the law, for the law requires a son of Aaron to be high priest, but Christ was not a son of Aaron, yet he is our high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Before we look closer at those verses, we have to ask the obvious question. If Christ did away with the law and gave us a new one, why would we have to change the old law? Wouldn't he have said, "There is made a necessity to replace the law"? There is no need to make a change to a law that is being replaced. Now, if the only part of the law that is different is the priesthood, then it is the same law, only revised. Scripture does not speak of a new law or a replacement law, but rather a revised law and administration.
For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning priesthood. And it is yet far more evident, for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there ariseth another priest, who is made not after the law of a carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life. For he testifieth, Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. For there is verily a disannulling of the commandment going before for the weakness and unprofitableness thereof. For the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh unto God. And inasmuch as not without an oath he was made priest.
This change to the priesthood was the subject the author of Hebrews was addressing in Hebrews 8 as well. How the Levitical priests did not properly administer the first covenant, and thus God found fault with them and replaced them with a new priestly order.
For finding fault with them, he saith, Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah.
The translators erroneously inserted the word covenant in verse 7, trying to make the covenant itself faulty when it is clear it was not the covenant, but them charged with keeping the covenant that were faulty.
For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second.
Then in verse 8 he says, finding fault with them, not it. Clearly, the translators made a mistake there by adding the word covenant to that verse. The covenant came from God, instituted by God's hand, Moses. There's nothing faulty about it. To say the covenant was faulty is utterly preposterous. The priests were faulty, not the covenant. They even crucified the Lord of glory. What more evidence do we need of their faultiness? It was the administrators of the law that were faulty. God created a better covenant and instituted a better priesthood, but the law remains the same. Christians often quote 2 Corinthians 3 as their proof that the law is done away with.
For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious.
Thus, they seriously ripped that verse out of context, for it was not talking about the law being done away with in that verse, but rather the ministration or administration of the law. Let's put it back in context.
But if the ministration of death written and engraven in stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious.
The subject there is the ministration of the law, not the law itself. The law is not done away, the law is written in your heart by the Spirit. Thus, the ministration of the Spirit. Friends, don't fall for the clever lies of the religious who seek to replace God's law in your heart with their own man-made fantasies in an effort to turn you away from God to follow them. They only seek to control you, whereas the true ministration of God's law by the Spirit of love is true freedom indeed, not bondage and death as they try to claim. They promise you liberty, but they themselves are the servants of all corruption, being completely lawless and thus godless.
While they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought in bondage.
Peter had much to say about people who were lawless. He called them anarchists.
But chiefly them that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise government. Presumptuous are they, self-willed, they are not afraid to speak evil of dignities.
They speak evil of those who preach dignified behavior in obedience and compliance with the law of God. Peter says they aren't afraid to speak evil of dignities. Christians do this all the time. If you preach that they must still obey God's commands, they will call you a devil. They'll say you're a legalist which to them is a dirty word. This was nothing new to the disciples, apparently. They saw this sort of abuse of grace and lawlessness even in their day. Here's more of what Peter had to say.
And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of.
So he's actually making predictions here. Predictions that came true in a startling way. Now when you preach the way of righteousness, they will call you evil. They are truly lawless, teaching that you cannot cease from sin because of original sin, and therefore they are cursed children, according to Peter.
And shall receive the reward of unrighteousness, as they that count it pleasure to riot in the daytime. Spots they are, and blemishes, sporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you, having eyes full of adultery, and that cannot cease from sin, beguiling unstable souls, and heart they have exercised with covetous practices, cursed children, which have forsaken the right way, and are gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness.
When you replace God's law with your own, you are indeed amoral. Merriam-Webster, amoral. Number one, A, having or showing no concern about whether behavior is morally right or wrong, amoral politicians, an amoral selfish person. B, being neither moral nor immoral specifically, lying outside of the sphere to which moral judgments apply, science as such is completely amoral. W.S. Thompson. And number two, being outside or beyond the moral order or a particular code of morals. Someone who considers themselves above the law or a moral code of society is amoral. They make their own rules as they go along. This is exactly what Christianity has been doing for centuries.